You're in the seminar of how the Dutch Socialist Party made the transfer to CiviCRM and adapted the program to its needs. The focus in this seminar is on the things that were custom built for the Socialist Party to give you some idea of how we tackled some of the issues we had with using CiviCRM. These are the topics or subjects for this seminar. I will shortly introduce myself, the party I work for, and the people who helped us make the transfer to CiviCRM. I will then let you in on why we choose CiviCRM, because there are all kinds of other programs out there, but we made the choice for CiviCRM. Then I will tell you something more about the whole transfer to CiviCRM. How we use CiviCRM and how we integrated CiviCRM on our website. Then I will talk to you about our local branches and how we adapted CiviCRM to their needs so that they could use CiviCRM on a local level. And if there's still time, I want to talk to you about how we tackle the problem of debtor management. Sometimes for direct debits comes with invoices, and invoices comes with a whole lot of other problems or challenges. And in the end, if we still have time, I would like to talk to you about new developments, the wishes we still have as an organization for CiviCRM for the future. My name is Oane Sikkema. I work for the Socialist Party at our head office in the Netherlands in Amersfoort. Some of you familiar with Amersfoort? It's somewhere in the middle of the country, near Utrecht. Yeah? Rings a bell? Yeah. All right. You can contact me always through osikkema@sp.nl if you have any questions later, or if you thought, well, he had something very interesting to say, but I don't know what it was anymore. You can always contact me. Then there's Jaap Jansma in the room. He's from CiviCoop. He's in the brown-orange jumper. You can contact him always through jaap.jansma@civicoop.org. And finally, we have Kevin Levy. He's also a member of the Socialist Party. He knows our party inside out, and he was the project leader of the whole transfer to CiviCRM. I don't have a technical background, so if you have really technical questions, they are here to answer them. A very short introduction about the Socialist Party. We are not here to talk politics, although I could do that for hours and hours and hours, but this is about software. But the Socialist Party was founded in 1972. And then we had some 200 members, and everything was done on paper still. The 3rd of May 1994, we had our major breakthrough in Parliament with two seats, and at around that time we had about 15,000 members, and we started to centralize also the administration, and for the first time really used computers for the administration. On the 9th of October 2015, that was today. My watch says it's the 8th of October, so sorry. We have around 42,679 members. I don't go to read them all out to you, because it just gives you an idea of all the context, all the different things that run through CiviCRM at our office. But we have 23 members of parliament in the House of Commons and in the House of Lords, as they say here in the UK, or not? Yeah? So that's a short introduction of the SP, Socialist Party. And why we choose CiviCRM had mainly to do that we weren't satisfied anymore with our supplier of the old software. They kept promising us new developments, and year after year they showed up with nothing. So we got very angry with them because we started out with them when they were still a little company, like CiviCRM, for instance. We really pioneered with them, with also helping them with a lot of issues they had with our new program, new software. And we thought, well, hard done by them changing the whole business model they had. And so we sat down together and told us, right, well, we can do that ourselves or we can change the software. We came up with a list of demands, and the version I saw the other day was 12 pages. So we had a list of demands of 12 pages. I don't know if that was the demand, the list of demands that we used for our search, but we tried to think of everything that we thought would we would need in the new software. For us, it's, we had a by then we had a preference for open source software versus proprietary software. We used to work with proprietary software. And yeah, and we were thinking, well, you need some agile development. You need to sometimes build things on your feet. Well, you have now you have a problem, and you want to solve it, and not wait six months or a year or whenever your supplier comes up with a solution. You want to be able to build it for yourself or with the help of others. And since it was an integral part of our political program, it's even in our, how do you say that, if you have an election, you have a program. Yeah, and that meant that if you put it in your program, you had to put your money where your mouth is, you had to set the example. And that is, in short, why we choose CiviCRM. There were other programs, but in the end, we started the whole journey with CiviCRM. With the transfer to CiviCRM comes a lot of challenges. What to do with all the old data? We had about 148,000 different contacts, and with different contacts comes a lot of different fields, contact fields, membership fields, event fields, you name it. So you have to multiply it bit by 100 to know the difficulties you face with migrating old data. So it took us quite a few runs to get it right. And you also have to get an idea what to do with all the history. Do we all take all the history with us to the new program? Or can we park the history, the data, somewhere else so that it would be accessible, but not in the new software? So. And choosing new software means also adapting to new software, and also means changing the way we work. So we had a lot of heated discussions about, well, we always do it this way, but CiviCRM gives you a whole new opportunity, so maybe you can better do it differently. And with the when we started the development, we started out with 100 different kinds of script scenarios. A script is like you started, well, a member logs in, a member comes on the website, he's not a member yet, but he fills out the form and what step by step what is needed to have an active membership. And we did it also for events and for contributions, etc., etc. So we had an idea step by step of what was needed. And then we sat down for almost a year, one day per week, to try to solve most of those scenarios in standard CiviCRM, but not everything got solved in standard CiviCRM, so we needed some other solutions, and I'm going to talk to you today about those other solutions. And then sitting down one day a week gave me a lot of insight in the new program, so I was half a year working with CiviCRM, I was very confident about the program, but then you have to tell your other co-workers that they have to start working with new software in a week or in a month. But I kind of can say that it went very smoothly, the whole transfer to CiviCRM. I didn't have many complaints. Web integration. We use, for all our websites, we use Drupal as a CMS. Is that the correct phrase? CMS? Yeah. And that gave us a lot of possibilities we didn't have with the old program and the old website. Nowadays, a member can log in with his own account on our website. And it's a very plain, and I will show it to you within a few moments. It's a very plain, what you see is what you get website. Easy to navigate, easy to find your way around. And a lot of those blocks were built with using CiviCRM rights and Drupal roles. Actually, they aren't rights in CiviCRM, but it's a combination of relationships. A relationship tells you which kind of Drupal role someone has on the website. But it also meant if the local chairman wanted to have access to its own members through his or her own CiviCRM, that you have to give them some kind of way in to CiviCRM. And that was something we had to solve as well. And members can now manage their own membership details through their own account. So they can log in and change their own data through their own account. And on our website, they can catch up on everything the Socialist Party does. This is the homepage of the dashboard of our website. You notice we have a slightly different website. This is something Kevin Levy built for us. If you're working with CiviCRM on a day-to-day basis, you need different ways to look up a context inside CiviCRM. And Kevin came up with this quicker way of looking things up. So if you're on the phone talking to someone, he gives you your details, you can easily find him through his ID or his postal code and number of his house, etc. You can also use, of course, in the left, find contacts. But we, because it's better to have more than one way to find contacts. Oh yeah, I maybe went over too quickly with the SPNet, but on the SPNet are all our. Maybe I'm just going. Yeah, this is the membership website. If you're a member, when you log in, this is the front page of the website, and those are all the different blocks on our website. You can go to. We have now an election about who will be our new chairman of the party. You can go register to a debate about how to save science. You can go to our youth organization. Tomorrow there are conferences all over the country. What kind of jobs people we need. We have now a member for our web team, and so on and so on. So this is what our membership website. It's a very plain, very simple website. But then you have to tell. CiviCRM works differently for different organizations because organizations all have different demands, different setups, different structures, etc. So you have to tell CiviCRM how your party is organized. And you have to fit your organization into CiviCRM in a way. And this is a bit, a very rough structure about how our party is organized. We have this national party, and then there are 12 provinces in the Netherlands, and they are divided in 20 regions. And we have about 163 local branches, and all those members belong to one of those local branches. How did we solve that puzzle? We did it by getting a postal code database. I don't know if you were in the lightning talks yesterday, but there was a guy offering some information about CV postcode. But we have a subscription to a postal code database. So if you put in your postal code database, it automatically looks up which street you live in and in which town you live. And we combined that with CBS data. CBS data is free in the Netherlands. It's our Central Bureau of Statistics who offer information about municipalities, etc. So based on the postal code database and with the help of CBS data, we were now able to determine in which city, in which municipality somebody lives. And in that way, we could link our members to our local branches and our local branches to the respective regions and the provinces. We also are very, sometimes we like to do things the old-fashioned way. We still distribute our magazines through volunteers. And our local branches get some money if they, which corresponds with the total amount of magazines they distribute themselves. And so we had to find also a solution for that. And we also had to find a solution to put it all into numbers. So if local branch X get distributed an X amount of magazines, and at the 1st of May or at the 1st of October, they had like 200 local members. And based on that, they get their funding. Can everybody see this? Yeah? So these are this is my page in CiviCRM. You find all the normal details. This is my user ID, which means that I have an account on the website in Drupal. And this is what I was talking about. Here now I can change the address based on the postal code database. And it will automatically change through a cron job also the municipality. It's all in Dutch. I asked Jaap to set it in English, but it's all in Dutch. But so gemeente means municipality, so I now know I live in the municipality of Amersfoort. And I'm now, through this, we call it geostelsel, but I now know that I belong to the local branch of Amersfoort, to the region of Utrecht, and to the province of Utrecht. And via this tab, I can give myself access to the members of to all the members of Amersfoort. So when I log in the next time, I can go to all the members of the local branch. Tuurlijk. Now these tabs are all in English, of course, but all our custom fields are all in Dutch, of course. But so I was a bit confused. Yes. So I told you more about how we told CiviCRM how our organization works, how our structure is, and so now our members are linked to the local branches. The members, one of our wishes was to have everything in one simple overview, so that if somebody calls and you looked up their personal details, you have it all in one page. In the old program, we had to click through several tabs to get all the data we needed. And with CiviCRM, you get everything in one simple overview. As a party, we have different kinds of memberships, free memberships, paid memberships, free memberships on our magazine, our scientific bureau. Is that the correct translation? Also puts out the magazine, and people can subscribe also to that. So you have different kinds of memberships. I won't talk to you about how you set it up, because yesterday we had a seminar on memberships and we talked in length about how to set that up. But we had the same problem with how to configure CiviCRM so that to all our memberships. And to make life more easy, they came up with the SEPA mandate. I don't know if somebody uses that in the audience. There's a single European payment area. If you have direct debits, you need to have a SEPA mandate. And you have to send that information with the direct debit to the bank in order to be able to get the money off the account of the members. And we had to find a way to make the transfer from memberships to contributions and from contributions to invoices. I have three different kinds of memberships, so a member can have more than one type of membership. And with this tab, and I think Jaap made that especially for us, for our organization, we now are able to tell, well, if you have a certain type of membership, you need a certain type of contribution. And this is also a trigger for the invoice. And this is, well, I won't go to you in length because nobody uses it, but this is the SEPA mandate. You need a status that is recurrent or a first, and if somebody changes their bank account, you have to set it again back to first, etc., etc. And you have to send this information out with a direct debit. And it took us quite a long time to really know how to use it, because the bank gave us other information than our supplier. So we had a lot of problems with the SEPA mandates and with the direct debit. So we lost a lot of money in that process, money that we didn't collect. That was one of the one of the reasons also why we left that supplier. And I showed you the card of just a member, but there's also information on our local branch. One of the problems we had also in the old program was the distribution of everything. We sent out a lot of news via email, but also through letters. We have to send out packages with stuff for campaigns, etc., etc. sometimes to different addresses in the same local branch. So we had to come up with a way of not getting stuff sent to the wrong address. And as you said, Netherlands is, consists of about more than 300 municipalities. So a local branch can contain more than one municipality. So we had to find a way to let CV know that, for instance, the local branch of Amersfoort contains more than one municipality. And what was really nice in CiviCRM is that you have different relationships for everything. You can link all kinds of stuff through relationships with one another. Like if you're a family member, you can say with relationships you are a family member of that member and the other way around. I think you all know how relationships work so in Seaside CiviCRM, yeah, more or less. And of course, there comes a time to party or party time, elections. That's our bread and butter. So we, but there was also always a problem. We have candidates, and they first have to be elected, and a local branch has to get 30 candidates on the list, but they don't get all elected. But you want those information because you want to send out certain type of information to the candidates about what's expected of them. And so we came up with a list inside CiviCRM where the local branch can fill in, register all the candidates. If you have any questions, please raise your hand, or if anything gets lost in translation, please do. So I told you about the municipalities. Amersfoort has actually four municipalities. I won't ask you where those municipalities are, but all in the same neighborhood, of course. And this is what I was talking about, the delivery of our magazines. You have to be able to know where if a member where a member lives. You can pinpoint in which delivery area, I don't know if that's the correct phrase in English, but where you have to send, to which local branch you have to send the magazine to, and then the local branch knows, well, it's delivered by volunteer X or another one. So again, that's all things we had to come up with solutions ourselves, because this is standard CiviCRM. But it gives you an idea, if you have problems for yourself, that CiviCRM is a very flexible program. With help, you can solve a lot of those issues inside CiviCRM. So you don't have to go outside CiviCRM to create new solutions. For instance, we had in our old program, we had to do a lot of stuff still in Excel, you know, and we wanted, well, you have all the numbers in your software, but you still have to go outside your software to do the numbers. And nowadays, we can do those inside CiviCRM. And here you can, a local branch has, well, this local branch in particular has about 59 kinds of different relationships to their members, with their members. And you can also see that here you have to put in that the local branch of Amersfoort is related to the region of Utrecht. And at the page of the region of Utrecht, you will find that it belongs, it has a relationship with the province of Utrecht. So that's how we tell CiviCRM how the structure works. So far, everything clear? And, well, it's not election time yet, so there aren't any lists, but here you can add candidates, and so we know which candidates belong to which local branch, so we can send out information to them. Well, they are already linked to the local branch. You have to be a member of a certain local branch to become a candidate. This is for the local elections, yeah? In the municipality. So you have to already live in the local, in the municipality to be able to become a candidate. So CiviCRM already knows that you belong to that local branch.
So when, so that button there is adding a new candidate?
Yeah.
And what is that actually, is that like, is that a custom?
That's also a custom, custom build for us.
Okay.
It's through a profile or? More or less. Yeah. Submit, submit.
It's creating a relationship.
Yeah. Yep.
It's not really creating a relationship, it's a custom field set. Okay. We have a contact reference and an option list with all the elections. So if you have an election in 2015, or I'm not sure, but there's a button which says kissing, which means election. Then you could select an election, and then you could add a candidate contact, and then probably a position number, which position on the list. And that's basically it. Because you can make this, those things are really complicated, but they aren't really complicated at all.
Yeah. We like simple solutions. Just to show you, with this simple button, well, there's a lot of technique behind it, but pushing this simple button, we now know I have to how many funds a local branch gets. So CiviCRM does now does the numbers for us, and we can send out a report to the financial administration that they can send out the money to the local branches. And it used to be us transferring the data to an Excel, then from that Excel to another Excel, and then from that Excel to, yeah, so rubbish, of course, but yeah. And it saves us a lot of time, and time we can now spend on helping local branches to work with CiviCRM and other things. And with this button, you can determine how many magazines a local branch has distributed that month. So again, that took a lot of talks with CiviCRM to get so that they got an idea how we wanted it done. It's not just 1 hour, and then he comes up with a solution. And then you say, well, that's not exactly what we wanted. And then it took some to and from, you know, talk to our suppliers. To CiviCRM, he gets very mad when I say that.
Partners,
because we have a very clear picture of how our party works, but then you have to translate it to the partners in order to so that they can come up with a solution.
Can I ask?
Yeah.
Do you have any problems with the IBAN accounts? You've got people's bank
details. Yeah.
For direct debits. Does that cause any problems, or do you have to have any special safeguards?
The safeguard is, what do you mean by special safeguards?
Well, presumably not everybody that can log in can see all those.
No. I will show you, because we had to come with the solution for the local branches. We didn't want them to see all the financial stuff. And there were also privacy issues. You don't want to let...
Yes.
Well, I will show you that in a minute as well.
Yeah.
Yeah. So now we come to the local branch. We now have told CiviCRM how our organization works. And the next phase was, in that phase, we are still in that phase, we are still testing it out with a few local branches. In the summer, we had a lot of talk about how we can solve also that puzzle, but also other puzzles we had, because what do you want to give it to? You have to be the, quote, responsible parent when it comes to privacy issues, but also with what you think is, well, you have different local branches with different volunteers, someone who doesn't know anything about technique, and somebody who is very tech-savvy, and you have to come up with some kind of middle way so that everybody can work with CiviCRM. So we stripped it down to its bare essentials, so what we thought they needed. And also, what's very helpful is that local branches can manage their own local information about their members. So if you want to become an active member or not, or you want to go out handing out leaflets on the market, or help with building the website, or maintaining the website, or support the local council members, etc., etc. So you can all record those information on the page of the individual member. And they can manage those information now themselves. Okay. Yes, you will notice this is the local branch. I'm now logged in as a local branch, you see a lot of less menus they can choose from. And if I go to my home page, you will have noticed that there are a lot of tabs missing on that on the page as well. So that's how we with CVC, Jaap can maybe go into detail on how it was done, but so this is what you see as if you are a local member. So you don't see the IBAN account, so you don't see their personal bank details. You don't see if they are behind in payment or anything else. Let us worry about that, not the local branches. And you can see what kind of memberships he has, relationships, and this is where you can put in details if somebody wants to become active or not. So if I edit it, it gives me an option to a list of things I can do for the. So I can tell the program that I don't want to be active or that I want to be active, and the things I want to do for the local branch. It's a list that we came up with, but it's also a list that you can add new stuff to. And this is where we can register what kind of work you do. Because that may be of interest if there's a new law coming up about education and you're working at the school, it's maybe for our best interest to know how you think about the new law, what kind of look you have on that issue, etc. So we can take it in account when we do the debates in the parliament. And also to which union you belong, etc. But also if you are interested in topics on environment or on international subjects, etc., etc. And this again is managed by through the local branches. We can alter them, but nowadays, but that's done through the local branch. So they go to visit the new members, they do the talk, and they register everything that is useful for the local branch. Does it help solve you anything, or gives you new ideas about how to solve your own? Is there an organization here with local branches, or yeah? So it can be done, and you can give local branches their own access to their own members.
Not everything, and that's what you've done.
That's what we've done.
Well, it is difficult to do in the sense that you can restrict Socialist, but there is a lot of CiviCRM functionality that will, it remains open, so we have to filter the activities list and filter some things, some functionality in mailings, etc. It was harder than we thought to make sure they don't see.
It looks, the end result looks easy, but there's a lot of technique also behind it, but it can be done.
We really want the learning to be able to see their name and maybe their postcode and their email address and then send an email.
Sorry?
We just want them to be able to see the name, postcode and email.
So
and
less than what's shown here?
Yeah, I guess so. Or not yet.
Yeah.
But also send, can you also allow them to send a mail?
Yeah. Yes, and we have also, not yet now, but I saw yesterday talk about simple mail. We also are thinking about certain templates so that you can use their own, the SP logo and the our house style. How do you call it?
Sorry, can they edit as well? Or is that
sorry?
Can they edit and update?
They can add and update certain fields on work and interest and if somebody wants to become active or not. And they can, because we thought, we had a long discussion about should they be able to do to alter the data themselves, or should we, because we are responsible for all the data inside the CiviCRM. And we think the data inside CiviCRM is of very high quality. There are not a lot of double entries, et cetera, et cetera. So we came up with a solution that through a they can send changes through a form, and that is logged as an activity inside CiviCRM. So every morning we go to the report about on those activities, and we can see the changes that were made overnight or the other day, and then we can say, well, this is okay. So or if there are still some changes to be made, we do the fine tuning, as I would say. Yeah. And maybe if in the future we will let them do it themselves, but nowadays we just want to have some kind of filter. Yeah.
In the other direction, is it possible to anonymize it even further so they can send emails to a particular branch, but they can't see the information until somebody responds to the email? So they don't have any access to data whatsoever.
But they can send us a mail through city mail to their local members without seeing the individual members' data.
Okay. That looks like a problem.
It's just because we rely on volunteers, they're not party officials in any way.
Yeah, all our local branch members, all of those local branches are all volunteers. So it's kind of maybe a question of trust, I think. And that's also, well, somebody spells names differently, somebody spells, you know. There are also kind of ways, if you're an administrator, you know that people can type in things in 10 different ways you didn't think about.
So if somebody fills out this form and submits, you see that they've submitted those details, but can you then just approve and it goes straight in?
I don't approve anything. Like that's not the bottom, so a yes or no, or approved or not. But I go to there, if I see something that's odd or I think that is not correct, I go to the page and I correct it by hand, manually.
So it's been submitted.
Yeah. But it's already inside in CiviCRM. Yeah. So the changes are made inside CiviCRM, but then I can, with that report, can see if all the changes were made correctly.
Yeah?
Yeah? No.
Okay.
No, but you have still.
So looking on the experience now, on hindsight, would you?
Well, this is just a test with five local branches.
Okay.
And in half a year, we have hopefully all the 163 local branches are working with it. So the test isn't conclusive about the quality of the changes they make.
Right.
Yeah. So, we thought out of a few local branches that we thought we could trust testing this out. Where we had a good relationship with or a good understanding with. And also, we trained them before the test on how to use CiviCRM. So, we still have to train all those 163 branches next year. So,
when did you introduce
it? I didn't tell you. We went live in February. Yeah, so we are working with it now for 8 months. Yeah. And we, maybe it's also very interesting, we didn't, because you have to, how do you say, double enter. Also in the old program, in the new program, we did it for about a week. And then we had enough confidence to work with CiviCRM and discard the old program. But that's because also we had worked for like over a year on how to use CiviCRM. So we had a very good idea what CiviCRM was capable of. Hans. What do you mean?
Well, in CiviCRM you have an option to show all custom fields to a person unknown.
That sounds to me like a technical question or something.
Standard functionality, access control lists.
But then also
you turn
on a certain group.
Sorry?
So people in a certain group can see.
Yeah, exactly.
Does it naturally give everyone access and you have to take it away?
Yeah.
Or is it no one has access and you have to give it?
Yeah, you have to strip the program. So normally you would have, you would see all, and then you have to cut it back or how do you, So this is how we want our local branches to work with CiviCRM, and hopefully that they get the most out of CiviCRM in this way. All right,
joining people or registering people for certain events.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe the chairman can register some people.
If you, what I showed to you on SPNet, sometimes we want that only a local chairman can register someone for a certain kind of course. And we have installed it via sending an email with a link in it, somebody can register themselves through the website, and then it's going to be registered in CiviCRM. So it gives you a lot of more possibilities on events and on campaigns and stuff like that. I think we're still running on time. Maybe it wasn't on the local website, Vue in Odoo. Missed it? Yeah. But normally on our live website there's a button called Vue in Odoo. And Odoo is originally a software package, an open source software package from France. You maybe have heard of OpenAir. They changed the name to Odoo very recently. And it's it's a software package our financial administration use for all their, for all the things they need to do. And we use Odoo to all do all the direct debits to send out the banks to, how do you call that? You have to download the bank statements into your program. And then I have to match all the details to the right member. So that's all done inside of Odoo, and Jaap built a tool, an API, so that CiviCRM can send out information to Odoo, and then Odoo can send information back to CiviCRM. So we know that a certain contribution has been paid or not, or that it's still open. Or and with one push on the bottom view in Odoo, we can go to the Odoo to see the invoices and which one is paid or not. So that helps us a lot, because when we started with CiviCRM, CiviCRM didn't really have a solution for that problem. There are now some new developments about direct debits, but we decided to not wait for that, but use Odoo instead. It still doesn't work the way we want it. The technique is there, but it's not up to our standards. It takes too long to handle things. So we are still configuring the Odoo to work faster than sometimes it's very difficult. I think in that Dutch, and I have to translate it directly to them. And I can show you that in the settings.
Yeah, but that worked not, but then you have to contact them with the server.
Okay. Well, normally there would be a list of settings, so the financial type, and in CiviCRM has to correspond with the financial type in Odoo. So the CiviCRM knows that if Odoo knows that if CiviCRM sends out that it's this financial type, then it corresponds with that type in Odoo. And that's what I also said in the. And don't ever touch it again, because it's it was very hard work to get everything straightened out, so that the information in CiviCRM got to the right place in Odoo. Are there any questions about this? Because Odoo is another program altogether. So anybody has the same problems or came up with different solutions for this or?
Yeah. Although we were connecting programs, we were also connecting work, how people work. So
workflows, yeah. Yeah. So nowadays we have a kind of a backload still on on our invoices and our bank statements, but we're getting there. Well, I'm here, of course, to at this conference to hear about new developments. We also have our own wishes, and what it says here is that we are, of course, still hoping to get more out of CiviCRM to benefit our struggle. We are not we are a political organization. We help support local branches setting up their own direct actions, their own campaigns, their own demonstrations. Tomorrow we have a big demonstration against TTIP. You may have heard of that. We are having a big rally on inequality, which is ongoing, and we want to see if we can do that all through CiviCRM and all those campaigns, all those activities. And we're still that's in the second phase of the development, or the third phase, because the second phase was the local branches, and this is now. What we are thinking about for the future. And very important on that is also that we have a lot of sympathizers, but who aren't members. And we still want to be in any shape or form in touch with those sympathizers. And nowadays, those sympathizers are in smartphones or on an Excel sheet or even on paper or just inside somebody's head. And we want to be able to register them. Not as a member, but as a sympathizer, or they can register themselves if they are involved in a certain campaign. And we want to also do more with that. And maybe also, yeah?
Sorry, do you currently have non-members on your database?
Yeah, we have, because our events are also open for non-members.
So can they just sign up on your website as a non-member? Just to get
no.
It was sealed off, it was on a remote desktop somewhere, and it's only contained members, And there are all sorts of separate databases for petitions, for newsletters, etc. So we're in the process of consolidating them all. And well, as far as I'm concerned, this is just the beginning. Ideally, you would have information about 16 million Dutch and what they like and what they're interested in and how to contact and target them instead of.
We have big dreams.
This small group of members.
But nowadays we have also non-members because events like the debate I showed you about how to save science is also for non-members. You can register, but somebody has to do it for you. I have to register you if you want to go to that, or you have to call our office. But we want it in the future that you can go to a button on our website and you can register yourself. And we want to think about how to work with CV rules on that also, to automate those things, to send out certain types of email, et cetera, to specific for specific topics or in general. And what we as an administrator think CiviCRM is still a bit lacking is a useful change log. So as an administrator, when it comes to workflow, when it comes to people, sometimes you have to discipline people in how to work with CiviCRM. And then it's very easy, very good if you have some kind of change log. You can see, administrator, for instance, me, put in some kind of data, changed the data, but did it in a way that is not good. Well, I changed something, and then you can always change it back to the old situation, or you can figure out what went wrong on the way. And if you look inside CiviCRM, you can see what's the new situation, but it's very hard to see what the old situation is. So you miss also the old information, and sometimes that's very useful. As for instance, for administrators like us, that's very useful. So we also want to talk and see if we can. Get someone to work on a useful change log.
Can you not just turn on change logging?
Yeah, but that does only work on certain types of fields. It doesn't work. We tested it out on our test site, but there are still some issues to be solved around the change log for our organization.
Unless it seems to become rather slower if you have 150,000
complaints. Yeah, because you're building also the databases. Hey, you have to log that somewhere, you have to store that somewhere, so you have to also the technical come up with a technical solution for that because you don't want to slow the program down. So that's something we are working on. That's something we think of, well, that's very interesting also for other organizations to work on. Yeah?
You might, at the moment, it's either everything or nothing.
Everything or nothing.
Yeah. Because that's what we. Yeah. Because if you're an administrator working with 42,000 active memberships, not a lot goes wrong. But when something goes wrong, you want to be able to detect or be able to find out what went wrong, or is it something inside CiviCRM, a bug or something else, or was it somebody who was. Again, working on an email and getting a phone call and getting a colleague to the table, and then you forgot to do some kind of stuff. So it's very easy to have such a change log. Yeah? Well, this was the what I had in plan for you to talk to you about this day. So if there are any questions, I think we're right on time. Yeah. So a big applause for yourself. Yeah? Yeah, but if you have any questions, we are here all day, and technical questions, please, for Jaap, Jansma. And you have, I can go back to the